Okay, again, sit up straight. So now I have tremendous pleasure. This is great pleasure. I'm not even going to say pride anymore, because this is somebody I went to school with, is Professor Ashwin Mahalingam from IIT Madras. We've been very naughty together in school. I'm very glad his parents are also here, because they are testimony to that. But he is now a very, very well-respected, very well-established academic, and also serves on a lot of civil projects which concern the city. Ashwin and I very recently got together to perform on stage, where we actually put together Einstein and his views on music. Today, he's going to present something very, very interesting on music and its relation to chess. Okay, how many of you here play chess? So that's quite a lot, very good company. And have you ever thought about music having any relation to chess? I did not. Okay, some of you might have. But he's going to come up here and talk about it. So, Ashwin, over to you.
I'm still young enough to be able to jump up, so I'll take the short way. It's on. So, how are all of you? Fine, good. Okay, is everyone still awake? Feeling hungry? Yeah, okay. All right, so I'll make sure I'm done before lunch. So let me see, we have AVM, that's one school that's represented, and the colorful people here are DAV Public School. Any other schools? No? Okay. So let me tell you why I agreed to do this. One, as you saw in the last session, Anil can be very scary, right? So he's cold called me and made me do this, but also I did this because I love listening to him play the piano, and this is my excuse to get him to play. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about chess and music. I know some of these questions were asked in the earlier session, but since I was sitting in the front row, I couldn't turn my neck around fully. How many of you like listening to music of any sort? All right, everyone, fantastic. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure. How many of you are actually learning a musical instrument or learning to sing? Okay, quite a few of you. What are you learning? Some volunteers. What are you? Vocal. Okay. Keyboards. Fantastic. Guitar. Okay. Drums. Fantastic. Anyone learning the mridangam? Fantastic. That's the one instrument I learned. So I was hoping that I'll get some people who relate to me. Great. And how many of you? Again, you just raised your hands, but I couldn't see. How many of you know how to play chess? How many of you know the rules? Okay, almost everyone knows the rules. How many of you play chess with your friends or parents, etc.? Almost all of you. Fantastic. Anyone play in competitions? All right. We actually have some competitive chess players. Okay. Fantastic. Okay. So there was a very important chess match that happened, right, in Chennai a few weeks ago. Okay. What match was that? Carlsen against Anand. What were they playing for? They're playing for the world championship. Yeah. So what happened? Yeah, sadly, Carlsen unfortunately won. We tried our best to food poison him, but it didn't work. He brought his own cook from Norway, right? He refused to eat our mulaga bajis and unfortunately managed to win. But anyone go for any of the matches? Oh, fantastic. Wow. Which matches did you guys go for? Which game did you go for? Oh, you went for the last one. Okay. Anyone went for any of the earlier matches? Yeah, which game did you go for? You went for the seventh one. The seventh one was a quick draw, right? Yeah, okay. So unfortunately, you didn't get your money's worth in that game. Okay, so I want to ask the question that Anil asked. Do you think there's any connection between chess and music? Okay, can you think of any connections? Because if there is no connection, we can all go for lunch right now. Okay, can you think of any connection between chess and music? Okay. Any ideas? Think for a minute and tell me if you think there are any connections, any commonalities. Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah. So I think we just talked about memory. Memory is very important in chess. In fact, the thing that separates Anand and Carlsen and other top grandmasters from people like us is that they actually remember more about other games that have been played and are able to select the right moves. Yeah, some answers there.
Concentration.
Fantastic. Yeah. You can't lose concentration when you're singing, you can't lose concentration when you're playing, and you can't lose concentration when you're playing chess. Right? Unfortunately, I think it was in game 9, right? Anand actually had a very good position. He lost concentration. Right? And he actually made a mistake and lost that game. Yeah. Girl here. Fantastic. Yeah, so they are both very good hobbies. Okay, so that's another connection between music and chess. Great. For some of us, it's a profession, like my friend here. Yeah, but I'm in the sort of same boat as you are. I play chess for pleasure, I listen to music for pleasure. Great, fantastic.
The rhythmic movement in chess and the rhythm in music. Rhythmic
fantastic.
Movement.
Fantastic. Okay, there is. Okay, and I'm actually going to talk about, I'm going to actually show a slide about that. There's rhythmic movement in chess and obviously rhythms in music. So, yeah. One more. Analytical thinking, can you tell me a little bit more about what that means?
It's both applicable in chess as well as music. So that's why.
Yeah, but how? What do you mean by analytical thinking? Can you sort of explain a little bit, if you can? Okay, but all right. So there is some form of sort of structured thinking that you think is important in both.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Any other ideas? Yeah, there's a boy at the back there.
I remember reading somewhere that classical music is supposed to increase your thinking power.
Absolutely. There's actually something called the Mozart effect, right? And there's some scientists who basically did this study where they played Mozart in the background and found that it increases your spatial reasoning ability, right? And chess is, you know, you're looking at a space, you're looking at a board, and you're trying to come up with ideas that are spatial in nature. And so there's a theory around that, which sort of says that if you listen to classical music, your ability to recognize spaces actually increases, and it's called the Mozart effect. It's not fully proven just yet. These are hypotheses. Scientists are working on testing this, but you're absolutely right. There is such a connection that people are hypothesizing. Fantastic. Yeah, and then
planning ahead. You know, in chess, you plan ahead. Even in music, you plan what
Brilliant.
To do.
Brilliant. Yeah, absolutely. You have to plan ahead, right? Unless you're reciting from memory. This is, both of them are very creative arts. See, so 2 minutes ago, I said, is there any relation between chess and music? All of you said no, right? Now I start asking you to think about this. We've got, 10, 15 different kinds of connections? Yeah? So anyway, so chess and music are actually connected, not connected in sort of intertwined very directly, but there are commonalities between chess and music. Very simply, you know, one of the, when you actually talk about music, sometimes you use the same terms that you use when you talk about chess. Okay? So, for instance, you guys have seen, maybe in the Sunday newspaper or something, there'll be a small chess problem, right? So, find checkmate in 2 moves, or, right? There's Sudoku and stuff as well, but there's also a chess problem. I think, you know, when we were growing up, it used to be in every newspaper. Now it's been replaced a little bit by Sudoku. You guys have seen this, right? Find a checkmate in 2 moves, there'll be a small position. Right? I think it still appears in the Times of India or some of these newspapers. Anyway, those are actually called chess compositions. Right? And the people who set those problems are called chess composers. Okay? Similarly, in music, we have compositions and composers. Okay? Somebody talked about planning ahead. Right? In chess, one of the greatest strengths that a good grandmaster has is the ability to calculate. Right, these people are sitting there and they're not thinking about the next move. They're thinking about the next move, what the opponent will play, what will I play, what will he play. They're calculating ahead. Right? Again, if you look at particularly things like Carnatic music concerts, you find that vocalists are very often calculating, right? Trying to figure out what they're going to sing so that it falls within the bounds of the talam that they are singing to or that the piece is set to, etc. So this ability to calculate, right, again, is very important. Somebody said rhythmic movement. Right? That again is very, very important. In fact, in chess, people talk about harmony. Right? In music, people talk about harmony as well. Right? So I'll give you a small example of harmony. Okay? You guys can see this? Everyone can see it from the back? Okay, this is a position on a chessboard. This is actually from a game that Anand and Carlsen played. This is the fifth game. The first game that Anand lost. Okay? I want to point your attention to a couple of things. Carlsen is playing white, so he's here at the bottom of the board. Anand is black. Okay? Now just look at this. Look at these pawns and this king here that Carlsen has. Right? What can you see? They're all connected. Right? The king is supporting this pawn. That pawn is supporting the next pawn. You have nice connections between pawns. You've got a bishop that's sort of centrally placed. It can go in any direction. Right? On the other hand, look at Anand's position. What can you tell me about Anand's pawns? Black pawns. Right? You've got an isolated pawn out there. You've got another isolated pawn here. You've got another isolated pawn here. These are what we call pawn islands. They're not connected. Right? There's no harmony in the position. right? The moment he moves this rook somewhere, that pawn has no support. The moment he moves his bishop somewhere, that pawn has no support. There's absolutely no harmony in the position, right? So the rhythm, the harmony in Carlsen's position is much, much better than the harmony in Anand's position. Yeah.
This Anand's bishop is blocked. It cannot move anywhere.
And so Anand's bishop is blocked. Fantastic, right? So to get this bishop out, he has to make one maneuver there, then move it all across the board, right? Whereas look at Carlsen's pieces. All of them have space to move, right? So this is an example of a position where Carlsen has a lot of harmony and rhythm for his pieces, whereas Anand's pieces are just completely uncoordinated. And it was exactly this advantage that Carlsen used to outmaneuver Anand and win the game. Of course, it took him another 20-30 moves to do it, but it was this lack of harmony that somehow Anand got himself into, which led him to losing the game. So this issue of harmony, of rhythmic movement of pieces, right, is very common to both chess as well as music, right? And there are a number of these kinds of connections, right, in terms of the words that we use.
So I'm just going to butt in here to because you've just done these pieces yourself in class, so I'm just going to show you what that means. So I'll show you what a blocked chord is, and I'll show you what an open chord is, right? So supposing we take something simple, very difficult composition, right? You don't know what it is. So for this one, right, if I were to give you an blocked chord structure, this is how it would be. You can't see it here because I'm sitting up, but what's happening is my fingers are moving like bear claws. So I'm just alternating between two sets of chords. Typically, when you start learning to play keyboards or piano or whatever it is, that's how you're taught to play. You're just taught to play two chords, right? C major, D minor. C major, D minor. That's all. So you're just doing that. So whenever you have little brothers or little sisters at home irritatingly playing the same thing again and again, this is what you call it's blocked, right? The same thing, if I were to open it up and stay more in harmony, how would it sound? So the moment you open it up, right? Open harmony, right? So that's an Anand versus Carlsen. Sorry, carry on.
Great. And by the way, although I didn't say this earlier, if in the middle of what we're saying you have questions, you have points to raise, please go ahead and do this, right? This is a discussion, not a class. Okay, so we're not going to make you stand outside if you ask questions out of line. Yeah, however scary he sounded. Yeah. Great. Okay, so in addition to all of this, in these terms and so on, there are lots of examples where music has inspired chess and chess has inspired music, right? So what we're going to do is sort of tell you a few stories of how that's happened, right? So that you sort of appreciate the connection between music and chess. I'm going to start off with the story of Philidor. Anyone heard of Philidor? No? No one's heard of Philidor. Very good. I didn't expect anyone to have heard of Philidor. Philidor is sort of an obscure figure, lived in the 18th century. He was actually a professional musician, right? He composed operas. In fact, he composed about 20 plus operas, okay? So he must have been very successful, otherwise he wouldn't have been paid to compose so many operas. But of course, he was not so successful that we all remember him today, okay? But he had another skill, okay? He was also an excellent chess player, okay? In fact, he was considered to be the best chess player in the world during that time. Unfortunately, in those days, we didn't have world championships, right? So there was no official title, but he was considered to be the preeminent chess exponent of the day. And he made some contributions to chess, okay? He, in fact, contributed something called the Philidor's defense, okay? And for those of you who are interested, I'll just quickly show you what that is. Okay, so I have this, does everyone see this chessboard? Okay, so all of you, I assume, know how to arrange pieces on the chessboard. What's the most common move that you make? Yeah, which pawn? Someone said E4, technical notation, very good. Usually you move the center pawn, right? And usually it's the king's pawn that goes here. Okay, why do you do that? Why not move the corner pawn? Yeah. so that you can develop your pieces, okay? Yeah. So that you can control the center. Fundamental rule number one of chess, if you guys are going to play chess, if you control the center, you win the game. Right? Center is very important, and this is a good way of controlling the center. Put your pawn up front, okay? 6 out of 10 games that Anand and Carlsen played, this was what was played first, okay? What is Black's usual response? Same thing, do the same, right? Why should I let the other person conquer the center? Let me come in as well, okay? Again, 5 out of 10 games that Anand and Carlsen played, they did this, okay? Then very often what White does, someone said, develop your pieces, right? So they bring out the knight. Now this does two things. See, none of your pieces are doing anything sitting at the back rank, right? They're all sleeping. You want to get them out, get them into battle, right? So this knight is into battle, but also it's attacking this pawn. Okay, again, 5 out of 10 games that Anand and Carlsen played, this was the way they started, right? And what Anand and Carlsen did in each of those 5 games is the player playing Black moved this knight here, right? So he develops a piece as well, and he defends that pawn. Okay, so it's sort of 2-in-1, okay? But Philidor had a different idea. Philidor's idea was, rather than moving that knight, Philidor's idea was to move this pawn. Okay, so this defends, so the knight is attacking this pawn, that pawn is also have created a gap for the bishop to come out, right? And this variation is called the Philidor's defense, okay? And it's very popularly used. In fact, it's something that if you guys want to play, it's a good way to start playing a game. Now, the thing about the Philidor defense is that it's actually a very exciting opening. It leads to a lot of what we call combinations in chess. Anyone know what a combination is? Right, a combination, right, is a series of moves that leads to something unexpected. Okay, just leads to, you know, spectacular sacrifice of something leading to a quick checkmate, something like that. Right, so the game is not meandering along its normal trajectory. It sometimes explodes and reaches a conclusion quickly. Right, and the Philidor defense actually leads to a lot of such combinations. And Philidor has always said that music inspired him, right, with regards to some of the games he played and some of the combinations that he showed. So I'll show you a very simple combination, right, based on this position, which was actually not played by Philidor, but was played by his teacher. Right, Philidor has a teacher called Ligal, right, who learned from Philidor later and played this game when he was something like 85 years old. Right, so his teacher was actually playing White, and there's a person called Saint Brie. I don't know if he's a real saint or not, but his name was Saint Brie, who was playing Black. Right, so they reached this position. Right, and Philidor's teacher, I think, played this move. The other person. So they went along developing their pieces. Right, so he played this move, brought out his knight, brought out his White brings out his knight, Black brings out a bishop. Seems like normal stuff, right? Normal stuff. Good principles. Center. Bring out your pieces. But now Saint Brie did something astonishing. He did something stunning, something completely unexpected, right? He played this move. He took this knight and he captured this pawn. Seems like a very strange move. Why does it seem like a strange move? The queen, the knight was there in front of the queen. Right, just look at this position, right? The knight was blocking the bishop's access to the queen. You move the knight, and the queen is completely exposed. So Saint Brie must have jumped up, rubbed his hands in glee, right? And without a moment's notice, he captured the queen. And he probably thought he had won the game, right? Because the queen is the most powerful piece. But Ligal had a little trick up his sleeve. Here's what he did. He took this bishop, cut this pawn, and said, check. Okay, now look at this position. Where can the king move? Right, the king can't move here because the knight is protecting that square. The king can't cut the bishop because the knight is protecting the bishop. The king has to move up here. There's no other option, right? So Saint Brie said, that's fine. I've got this guy's queen. I'll move my king up front. And then Ligal moved his knight up here. Wow. And this is checkmate. This is checkmate, right? The king can't move here because of this knight. He can't move here because of the bishop. He can't move here because of this knight. He can't cut the bishop because of this knight. All the pieces are in harmony. There's a check and the king has nowhere to go. And in 7 moves, right, the game just exploded into a wonderful checkmate on the Philidor defense. So this is what we call a combination. Okay? And this notion of combination, right, although my term differently, also has some analogies in music. So I'm going to let Anil talk about that.
I think to some of you, we have talked about this. Those who are in the 9th and 10th in AVM will know about this. There's a concept called the fugue, right, which is also a contemporaneous development to Philidor's lifetime. So the fugue is, so let's say I take a tune. So that's the main tune, okay? I'll play that again. So people like Bach, you've all heard of Bach, right? His bark was worse than his bite. You've all heard of Bach. How many of you here have heard of Johann Sebastian Bach?
Fantastic.
Okay, good. No, AVM had better know about it. Bach, for DAV, was a great Western classical music composer. He lived from 1685 to 1750, which sort of puts him around the same time frame. And he had many students and disciples. I'm sure Philidor and others were influenced by Bach's music, because in 1720, Bach was to Europe what Qualavery is to us right now. It was very popular. Okay? So they all probably had heard of that music. And in the fugue, so Bach's idea was a combination. So what he said is the same tune, like doing a relay race. You know, you've all seen relay races, baton passing. If after one bar, what I play on the right hand, if I start on the left hand, then both the notes will interlock with each other in such a way that they will form a complete piece by itself. So I'll show you how that works. So what's happened is that the right hand has started it, but the left hand is giving one gap, right? That gap is important. It's the gap where the knight is getting moved, right? What's happened is the left hand is essentially played the exact same thing that the right hand is played, but because of that slight movement, it's formed what is called a combination. And this combination is called a fugue, right? Where it's the same tune if placed upon itself. In modern technology, we call it DTing, double track, okay? But the same tune placed on top of itself, but with a slight gap, can still form a complete composition by itself in harmony, and that's called a fugue. Have you understood what I just said? Some people are busy talking about something else. So I need to see everybody looking at me right now. As Professor Ashwin said, I'm very scary. Then I'll start asking questions. Test. What is a fugue? Okay, let me ask anybody here. Did you understand what the fugue is? Yes? Or do you want me to explain it again? Anybody can get up and tell me what it is? Yeah.
When a tune is played on itself, but with a slight gap, in this what you played is just one gap, I guess. Yeah. So
like that, there can be many examples. Good. So many examples. Okay. If you start talking amongst each other when I'm explaining something, then I'm going to have to ask you questions. I am very scary. I promise. So young lady right here, what did I just talk about? I know you were talking. That's the reason I'm asking. Okay, so can you all please pay a little bit of attention, because what we're saying is very serious stuff, okay? And if you really want to talk, my suggestion is going to be you go outside and talk and then come back, okay? Just because it's not a class, it doesn't mean that what's happening is not very serious. Please be seated. Okay? I'm going to explain this one more time. Okay? So like this, there are, Bach didn't create just one, he has created fugues in every single scale, every single note. So from C to C, okay, C, C sharp, D, D sharp, E, F, F sharp, G, G sharp, A, A sharp, B and C, in every single note, in both the major and the minor. So those who are doing Western music will know what is a major and a minor. These are different types of scales. So a major, minor, right? Similarly, major, minor. So he has composed fugues in every single one. So there are totally 12 tones, and there are majors and minors in all 12. And he's composed fugues in both what would be a sharp major and flat major. So it's 12 times 2 times 2, 48 fugues for every single key. That means he's found 48 combinations which are still being used today. Sorry. Okay, and like Professor Ashwin said, I will be very scary, so I am noticing who is talking, okay, and I will give punishment.
Yeah, so you all better pay attention. Okay. Anyway, so the point is that perhaps Philidor's training as a musician, right, and the fact that he was exposed to fugues and this notion of combinations in the world of music probably influenced him to create all of these kinds of combinations in chess, right? So that's another kind of connection between chess and music. Okay, let me tell you another story. This time about a person called Paul Morphy. Who's heard of Paul Morphy? No one? Okay. Paul Morphy lived in the 19th century in the US. And he was considered to be the best chess player in the US, right? In America. And people thought that he might be the best chess player in the world, but they weren't sure because, of course, in Europe also people are playing chess. So they wrote a letter to the best chess player in Europe who lived in London and said, can you please come to America and play against Morphy and the winner will be the world champion. Okay? But unfortunately in those days, how would you travel in 1870 or whatever from, you'd travel through ship. Right? How long would you think it would take from London to, take weeks if not months, right? And then once you came, right, you would probably have to, having spent 2 months on a boat, you would probably have to stay for 2 or 3 months to make your visit worthwhile and then take a 2 or 3 month boat trip back. So your shortest visit would be at least 6 months, right? So this person from the UK sort of responded saying, I mean, this is interesting, but I can't spare 6 months, right? And he was actually a doctor. So he said, I've got patients, etc. So I can't come over to the US. But if Morphy is interested, ask him to come to Europe. Right, we'll play with him in England, we'll send him to France, Germany, he can have a whirlwind tour. Morphy, of course, didn't like it because he didn't want to go for 6 months on a boat as well, but the American Chess Association or whatever persuaded him and put him on a boat and sent him to England. Right, and he went to England, he played some chess matches there, he actually won those matches. Then he went to France. Right, in France, he met two people. He met a person called the Duke of Brunswick. Right, so you guys have read all of these stories, right, about dukes and counts and earls and stuff. They actually existed in those days, right? So he met the Duke of Brunswick, who was German, and he met the Count Isouard, who was French, right? And the Duke and the Count were friends, and they met Morphy, and there were three things, right, that made them gel together, right? First, the Duke and the Count really loved chess, right? So they wanted to sort of get a hold of Morphy. Second, they were very rich, right? Which means they were able to pay Morphy, right? They were able to sort of put him up in the kinds of hotels you had in those days. They were able to pay him some amount of salary so that, you know, he could sort of buy food to eat and those kinds of things. And third, both the Duke and the Count were extreme sort of opera fanatics, right? They loved the opera, as did Morphy. Okay, so the third day that Morphy was in France, he learned that there was an opera called Norma that was playing, composed by a person called Bellini. Okay, how many of you have read Asterix comics? How many, right? Call it Asterix comics? Only very few. Okay. There are a few. Yeah. For those of you who have read Asterix comics, Do you remember a character called Getafix? Okay, what is Getafix? What is his profession? He's a druid. Okay? And who does Asterix and Obelix and the rest of the crew normally fight against? Romans. Right? So it's usually Gauls versus Romans. So this opera is actually an opera about a female druid falling in love with a Roman. Right? Set exactly in that Asterix and Obelix period. Right? And then there are other themes of jealousy and other kinds of things. So Morphy really wanted to see this opera. So he asked the Count and the Duke whether they could take him. And they said, yeah, yeah, we have a box at the Paris Opera House. We can sit right there, right in front of the stage, and we can see the opera. So Morphy said, fine. They went to the opera house. But when they got in, the Duke and the Count had seen this opera many times. Right? They'd already seen it 10, 15 times. They had no interest in the opera. So the moment they sat, they brought out a chessboard. Right? And they said, Morphy, now you play with us. Now, Morphy was irritated, right? Because he wanted to see the opera. He's come all the way from America, months on a boat. He's come to the UK. He's played chess. He's come to France, right? He wants to see the opera. But unfortunately, these guys are paying for him, right? They're paying him money. They're sort of putting him up. He can't say no, right? And so he had to play this game, okay? And his sole objective was to finish this game as quickly as possible so he could turn back and watch the opera, right? And what resulted, right, was a game of such astounding brilliancy, right, that it's called the, it actually has a name, it's called the Opera House Game. And even today, any beginning chess player goes to any of, you know, any chess club or any chess class. It's one of the first games that they're taught is this game by Morphy against the Count and the Duke, right, because it's featured exactly what we were talking about. It featured combinations, right, featured sacrifices, it just featured chess of the most amazing beauty and led to a very, very quick checkmate of the Count and the Duke, who were playing together. So they were actually discussing with each other, playing against Morphy. And it's very likely, and Morphy has sort of alluded to this later, that it was actually the opera that inspired him, right, to play that kind of a game. Right? Now, what I would have liked to have done is play that game out, but I think we're running a little bit short of time. Okay, so I won't play that game out, but we can talk about it later. But do all of you know what an opera is? Okay, so Anil, why don't you tell them a little bit about the opera? I have a clip from Norma that I can play as well.
Wonderful. So, how many of you here took part in the play for which you just did for the annual day? Some people there in the back. How many of you took part in the music that was there for the annual day? How many of you here like to dance? Okay, now imagine that you're going to put all of that together, right, and have one production. So you're going to have theater and you're going to have music, and as in the actors themselves sing and they dance. So all of this coming together is one particular form. Long before musical theater was invented, it was called opera, where classical music was actually created with libretto, with lyrics for people to sing. So in between them talking, they'll actually be singing, and you have a lot of great symphonic music. So an actual 60 to 70 piece orchestra will sit in the pit and be accompanying the players as they are on stage. And this usually took mythology, just like we would take Ramayana and Mahabharata, they would take you know, great mythologies, great stories from things like, have you heard of the Odyssey and by Homer, right, the Iliad. They would take Roman mythology, they would take different stories, different mythologies, and create an entire opera out of it. Operas are still very popular. A lot of people still go to them. The tickets are quite expensive, but it usually lasts like 2 to 3 hours, and it's divided into several acts, just like a play is divided into several acts. And the people on stage not only have to be good musicians, great musicians, but they have to be very good actors as well. So that's what an opera is. So Ashwin's going to show a clip from Norma. very, very interesting. The music will be interesting. Of course, everybody sings with that kind of voice, right? Which was, unfortunately or fortunately, that was the way sopranos were taught to sing. That's a certain... So, for a foreigner, if they listen to, for example, the way we do a Carnatic music, Alapana, it might seem very strange to them that people are doing... They'll be wondering, why are these people doing that, right? So, similarly, it seems funny to us. But it's a particular style of singing. It requires tremendous control over your voice and your throat. And they train for years and years and years. They go to conservatories and they train.
Yeah, and I've seen a few of those and they're spectacular. Okay, so I just, since I don't have time to play the entire game, just wanted to sort of play the crescendo, right? The part that, the last couple of moves where Murphy destroyed the Count and the Duke. Because look at this position. Murphy's playing white. The Count and the Duke are playing black. Look at Murphy. He's got his bishop attacking the king and the rook. He's got this other rook attacking that rook. This knight can't move because this bishop is attacking the queen. All his pieces are trained towards the opponents, king and queen. Look at the count and the duke. This bishop can't move. It's hemmed in. This knight can't move because otherwise the queen will be lost. There's absolutely no harmony among the pieces, right? So the count and the duke tried a last ditch attempt. They tried to free their queen so it could move. But Morphy captured the rook, said check. The count and the duke captured the bishop with the knight. And then Morphy started a spectacular sacrifice. Right? Went up with the queen and said check. Now what would you do if you were black? Right? Knight takes the queen. Right? And that's exactly what the count and the duke did. They probably breathed a sigh of relief. Okay? Now can anyone spot the winning move? Right? The rook all the way to d8. Rook all the way to d8. Now it has an open file and this is checkmate. Right? You can't capture the rook because of the bishop. You can't move here because of the bishop. You can't move there because of the rook. Checkmate. And in 17 moves, which probably took about 15 minutes, Morphy must have swiveled around, right, and started watching the opera again. And it was a 2-hour, 20-minute opera, so hopefully he didn't miss much, right? But again, point is that there is possibly some inspiration that he derived from the opera, right, that influenced this chess game, right? Great. Okay, so a couple of more things and then we'll sort of wrap up. Just wanted to talk about a couple of other connections. After Morphy's time, there actually was a world championship. The world of chess got together, they were world champions. And in the early 1920s, there was a Cuban grandmaster from Cuba. How many of you know where Cuba is? Okay. Can you name anyone from Cuba? Fidel Castro. Fantastic. Okay. Right. So Cuba is, anything exciting that comes out of Cuba? Yeah, Cuban cigars. Okay, you guys are too young. So maybe I shouldn't have asked that question. I take it back. Boxing, by the way. Cuba wins the most medals in boxing at the Olympics. Okay, so that's something more interesting to remember. But Jose Capablanca, this gentleman right here, was a Cuban chess player. Right? He was a grandmaster. He was the world champion from, I think, 1921 from 1927. And what differentiated him from most of the other chess players at that time was his ability to visualize. Right? He could just look at a board, right, and just visualize all the various permutation combinations. Right? In fact, he could play a lot of blindfold chess, right? Where you doesn't even have to see the board. Right? He can just visualize space. He could even play simultaneous blindfold, which means he can play 10 people. He would be blindfolded. He wouldn't see a single board. He would remember all 10 boards and play. Right? Today, most top grandmasters can do this. Anand and Carlsen can probably play 30, 40 people blindfolded. Right? But in those days, Capablanca was known for his ability to visualize and his stunning compositions. A very, very good friend of Capablanca was Prokofiev. How many of you have heard of Prokofiev? Okay, Prokofiev, again, was a very famous Russian composer, musician. And he was also a very good chess player. In fact, once Prokofiev beat Capablanca in one of these simultaneous displays. A very good chess player, right? But Prokofiev also, right, sort of had this in his music, and I leave Anil to sort of tell us a little bit more about it, had this ability to sort of bring in visual forms into his music.
So, there's a famous story in Russia, it's very similar to our story on the same topic, called Peter and the Wolf. It's about the boy who cried wolf. You all know the boy who cried wolf story? Does anybody remember the boy who cried wolf story? Yeah, can you get up and tell us what the story is?
During daytime, to just make mockery of the village people, he used to call out wolf to So the people will come and see there is no wolf. He just used to laugh at the people. He did this twice. Then the third time when he did it, a wolf really came. But the people thought he was mocking them again. So they didn't come. And all his sheep were destroyed.
Correct. Killed. So the boy who cried wolf is also used metaphorically in adult life also. But on Peter and the Wolf, there's a... He composed an opera around that whole thing. It's a very famous one. You can go on YouTube and listen to the whole thing. But Peter and the Wolf, for example, just like Ashwin was saying, very visual. So the theme of the wolf. So this whole thing nowadays, you know, when a villain comes, we do kind of thing. Or when a pretty princess comes, you do kind of thing. So all these kinds of entry musics that we create for various productions, that whole idea was pioneered by Prokofiev, that you would have entry music for different people. So just using the music, you can visualize what that character is going to be. So Peter and the Wolf was, so this is the wolf's entry, the real entry of the wolf. What I'm playing on the upper octaves is actually being played by a flute, and that's supposed to be Peter sitting with a little flute. The flute is what he uses to catch all the sheep to come back. And what's happening on the lower keys is the wolf, which is doing... So the wolf is looming close by, and Peter is thinking there's no danger, so he's doing... So he's doing that in that. So all this kind of visualization by just using music as a cue was done by Prokofiev.
And so this is probably an example of how chess influenced music, because Prokofiev's ability to play chess, the time he spent in the company of Capablanca, right, understanding, visualizing chess, probably helped him translate some of that into his music. Okay? So one last story and then we'll stop. And this is a story about Taimanov, okay, who actually is still alive. He's about 87 years old today. And he again is both a composer, a pianist, as well as a chess player. And interestingly, in Philidor's case, Philidor was famous as a chess player, also a musician, right? Prokofiev was famous as a musician, also a chess player. But Taimanov is actually equally famous in both. In fact, Anil knows of Taimanov independently as a musician, and I know of Taimanov independently as a chess player, right? How many of you have heard of Bobby Fischer? Right, Bobby Fischer was sort of like a Rafael Nadal, no? Sort of this freaky guy who sort of beats everyone. So if it hadn't been for him, Taimanov might have also become the world chess champion. And the thing about Taimanov, his contribution to chess, right, is in what we call variations in openings. Right, so we talked about the Philidor's defense, right? That's an opening. Now in that opening, there are many variations. Right? And what Taimanov did, he actually composed several variations on several openings. In fact, there are at least four openings in chess which have variations that are attributed to Taimanov. They're actually called the Taimanov variation. Okay? I'll give you one quick example. So there's something in chess called the Sicilian defense. Anyone heard of the Sicilian defense? Okay, some of you have. Okay? Anand and Carlsen in their last game played the Sicilian. So white plays the king pawn, but black actually responds with the queen's bishop pawn. The idea is he can bring his queen out later and his rook can come into that sort of open file and create havoc and so on. And normally this is what happens in this variation. Knight goes here and here. So this is the normal variation. Now what Taimanov actually proposed, and this last move by black allows this white bishop to come out. But what Taimanov actually proposed is to move this pawn instead, right? And allow this other bishop to come out, right? Which is a little bit of a variation on the theme. And if the game proceeded normally after this move here, exchanging pawns, hang on. Okay.
he recommended moving this night, whereas normally standard opening theory would recommend moving this night. Right? So Taimanov's idea was to move this night, and then perhaps after this knight moves here, move this pawn up to prevent any of the white knights sitting on that in that square. Right? So these were a set of ideas. So the Sicilian defense was not invented by Taimanov, but these kinds of variations. And he has, there's something called the Grunfeld defense. And Taimanov has a variation that he's popularized. These are very popular variations. Grandmasters today play these kinds of variations. And this notion of variations on a theme is actually something that's very, very central to music, where many composers have taken an existing theme and have composed variations on it to actually then come up with something creative and beautiful. And Anil will demonstrate a very well-known theme and its
variation. I'll take the well-known theme and variation. This is actually a request from Ashwin. So I'll play that. But just to show you that this we can do also in music. So I'll actually play the variations as a blindfold variation. So I don't think we have a blindfold here, but any of you is welcome to come and close my eyes from the back like you would do. Come and close my eyes. So this is again, of course, it's a nice little gimmick to do, but I'm not doing it because it's a gimmick. But I'm trying to tell you that if you practice enough, you'll be able to do it also. It's not that difficult. Okay, so we'll do variations, theme and variations on Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. Okay, and I'll play about 4 or 5 variations.
The point that Taimanov composed so many variations was not coincidence, right? It's his musical training in classical music that allowed him to appreciate the notion of these variations and compose them, right? So the moral of all of this, we've sort of spoken and played to you over the last 40-45 minutes, is this, right? 45 minutes ago, I asked the question, are chess and music connected? Most of you said no. And there doesn't seem to be any apparent connection, right? But if you actually go deeper and look at it, you find several connections. Right, and you find that chess has inspired music, music has inspired chess. And these kinds of connections are not just there between chess and music, they're there between various kinds of fields. Anil just told you about an earlier program that we did where we explored the connections between chess and science, right? Music and science. And we've also done, there's also other kinds of connections that you can establish, for instance, between nature and buildings, right? So seemingly unconnected themes actually have things that connect them. And if you guys can sort of start thinking about this, right? All of you are in 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th standard, something like that, right? So if you can start thinking about these kinds of connections, right? Then it's likely that at some point, you might actually find something inspirational or innovative that will hit you, right? That might be of great value as you guys go towards achieving these goals that would lead to success in your own words, yeah? So we just like to encourage you to think about connections, okay? So with that, we're done. I know we're a little bit behind time, but maybe if there are a couple of questions or something like that, yeah. Good. Take a few before we close. Any questions?
So we encourage you to play more music and also play more chess. Right. Okay?
And listen in class.
And please listen attentively when somebody is telling you. That, of course, we will continue telling you. Both of us are teachers, so you can't expect us to speak in any other way. Ashwin, of course, teaches much, much older people. Yeah.
Okay, I'm actually, I stopped learning Mridangam a long time ago, and I'm not really much of a chess player. I mean, I'm a chess enthusiast. So I've actually spent far more time in front of a chessboard than in front of a Mridangam, right? So for that reason alone, I think you probably have to say chess has sort of inspired me more. But although I learned Mridangam only for about 3 or 4 years, the knowledge that I gained then has helped me appreciate music in its broader sense, which has then helped me make connections with chess and with other kinds of activities, which have also resulted in inspiration. So it's difficult to sort of separate the two.
I think you should also mention who you learned those 3 or 4 years from.
Okay, so there's a person called Kumbakonam Rajapayar. He's passed away a few years ago, but he was probably the doyen of Mridangam teacher. So he's actually very, very talented Mridangamist, but sacrificed a performing career for a career in teaching,
yeah,
right? And he actually taught and trained a number of Mridangamists, several of whom are playing out there today. And unfortunately, I wasn't mature enough at the time to realize who I was learning from, otherwise I would have put in more effort. So that's again something that all of you, I think, should sort of think about.
Any other questions?
Did you guys enjoy it? Like it?
Is that a question or your hands painting?
Yeah, there's someone who's got a hand in his cast, so he's trying to exercise.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, on behalf of Rhapsody and Arsha Vidya Mandir, I represent both institutions, so I'll say on behalf of both. Ashwin, thank you so much for such a fascinating...
No, like I said, the only reason I did it was because I could get him to play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star and all the variations.
And I request Mrs. Raja, the correspondent of Arsha Vidya Mandir School, to hand over a token of our appreciation to Ashwin for having spent his time with us here today. And on behalf of Rhapsody and all the work that we're doing, so this is the second day of our festival to children. The third day is tomorrow at Vidya Mandir, and day after tomorrow will be at Bhavan's Rajaji Vidyashram, and we've got fascinating talks and performances as well. But on behalf of Rhapsody, I'd like Dr. Sudha Raja, the principal faculty of Rhapsody, to hand over a memento of our appreciation to Mrs. Nirmala Raja. Thank you so much, as usual, for encouraging us year after year. I believe the DAV public school children, now you'll have to get up very systematically and go to the bus, okay? Because you have to leave. Thank you so much for coming. Can we have a round of applause for them? So to all of you, class dismissed.
Namaste. It gives me great pleasure, and I consider this a privilege and honor to stand before you to offer this vote of thanks. Well, I must say, Arsha Vidya Mandir was blessed this morning to have such eminent, dignified, versatile, and accomplished artists visiting us and interacting with our students. This was a program with a difference. Don't you agree with me, students? Was it? Were you inspired? Okay. At Arsha Vidya Mandir, we place equal emphasis on liberal arts and humanities, such as drama, arts, and music, as much as we have for the science subjects. In this connection, we are very happy to hold this program in our school. At this outset, would like to thank Professor Dr. Ashwin Mahalingam, Dr. Anita Ratnam for gracing this occasion with your valuable presence. It was indeed a rare combination that you introduced us with, a fantastic way to link music with chess. Thank you so much, Dr. Ashwin Mahalingam and Ms. Dr. Anita Ratnam. I would be failing in my duty if I don't thank our mentor, Dr. Anil Srinivasan. Well, his interest and thoughtful interaction in all our music programs have gone a long way in terms of quality. Please. The most important thing is that he too believes in the philosophy of AVM, in integrating and linking music with all the other subjects and how meaningful it becomes. Thank you, Dr. Anil, for all the support and guidance and enthralling us with your music too. Would also like to thank Dr. Sudha Raja and team from the Rhapsody Education and Music for weaving this wonderful program together for us. Thank you so much. Last but not the least, would like to thank our dear correspondent and Mrs. Nirmala Raja and our Chief Program Coordinator, Mrs. Arpita Reddy, for always guiding and offering the best for us. Thank you so much. And finally, big thanks to the DAV students as well as our own dear children. And, you know, to keep thinking beyond your syllabi all the time. Be curious and always love your life. I think that's the learning we have to take back today. Thank you so much. Thank you. I would like Mrs. Nirmala Raja to give a memento to Dr. Anil Srinivasan as well as to Dr. Sudha Raja. Please come on stage, ma'am. I would also like to acknowledge the presence of Professor Ashwin's parents. Thank you for taking the time and being with us. Thank you so much.